Let's start with capital gains and losses. Highlight that. Now, just so that you know terms, letter A, highlight real property means land and building. Letter B, personal property means machinery and equipment. Now, what are the most common types of capital assets? Usually the examiners don't try to trap you on this, but just for your own reference, again, your automobile, furniture and fixtures, stocks and securities, personal property that is not used in a trade or business, real property not used in a trade or business, interest in a partnership, goodwill of a corporation, copyrights, literary, music, and artistic rights that have been purchased. So again, when you buy them, then you own them, then it's an asset of yours and it's a capital asset, or other assets held for investment. What are non-capital assets? Let's highlight this. Property normally included in inventory that's for sale to customers in the ordinary course of business. And I would underscore inventory and depreciable personal property. That's depreciable machinery and equipment and real estate used in the trade or business. For example, such as 1231, 1250 property. Now, circle section 1231. Circle that. And out in the margin, we're going to define section 1231. Put down M&E for machinery and equipment, and then put land and building. There are some other items. Accounts and notes receivable are not considered. Again, and I'd highlight that. I'd underscore those as well. And then notice copyrights, literary, musical, and artistic held by the original artist. Now, wait a minute. If we go back up above, it was a capital asset if you purchased it. It's not a capital asset if it's originally created by you. So why don't we circle those two? Circle original artist, and then again, circle purchased up above in C number 8 so that you can compare those two. So maybe you put an arrow between them and put compare, just so that you note the difference. If you bought somebody else's musical rights, then it's a capital asset. If it's your original ones, it's not a capital asset. All right. Now, notice the term 1231. I probably scared you a little bit by actually citing an Internal Revenue Code section, but it's one of the first and only times I'm ever going to ask you to know a code section, because it's one of the only times, it's the last time that you're going to ever be tested on an actual code section. How are you going to remember this code section? Well, since it's the first and last time I'm going to ask you to ever know a code section, help me out. Numerically, what's the last day of the year? 1231. And the last time I'm ever going to ask you to know a code section is 1231. So if you can remember the last day of the year, the last day of the year, the last time I'll ask you to know a code section, 1231, you've got it. Let's move on. Now, Schedule D is where you have your dealings in property. When you have a deal and buy and sell things, capital gains get shown here. Part one is your short term, which is assets held 1 year or less. Part two is long term, which is assets held more than 1 year. And then you can see it bleeds over onto a subsequent page there. Now, the calculation, if you'll note, it's a very simple one. We saw this earlier. It's the amount you realized, the amount you got, and then it's the adjusted basis of the asset equals your gain or your loss. Well, we're going to go through each one of those four lines and study each one very carefully for the issues that the CPA exam tests you on. So let's start with letter A and highlight amount realized. It's the cash received, which is boot. It's cancellation of debt, which is also potentially boot. Then it's property received at fair market value. It's services rendered at fair market value. By the way, there's our rules again. Anything else received, it's at fair market value. And then reduce the amount by any selling expenses, such as broker's commissions. Now, cancellation of debt is boot. And next to that, would you put excess? I just put the word excess. And then you can, again, kind of draw a circle around the two boots and then put taxable if gain. All right, we're going to talk a little bit about that. So if you have excess COD, or you have cash received, then you're going to have taxable events if there is a gain. And we're going to talk about that in just a moment. All right, now, the second item that we're going to cover is the adjusted basis. This is the second line of the calculation. Now, there are three ways that you can acquire something. You can buy it, It can be received as a gift. You can inherit it. Why don't you out in the margin put those three items down? Number one, purchase it. Number two, again, a gift. And number three, inherit. All right, now we're going to look at the first one. Letter B, adjusted basis of assets sold. Purchased property basis equals cost. Highlight that. And then circle the word cost. Letter A, it's increase the basis by any capital improvements. And letter B, reduce the basis by accumulated depreciation. I don't think anybody has a problem with either of those. All right, let's go to the second of the three ways that you can acquire property. Highlight number two, gifted property basis for gain and loss purposes. General rule, donor rollover cost basis. Circle rollover. And again, out in the margin, rollover cost slash net book value. Now, that's the general rule. There is an exception, and highlight letter B, exception, lower fair market value at date of gift. Now, the next page or so goes into a lot of details about what it means, but I'm going to illustrate that by visualizing it. I found that sometimes a picture is worth 1,000 words. You have, again, grandma gave you a gift. Let's say she gave you her car that's been around for 20 years. She paid a lot for it. It was a sports car when she was a young, swinging woman. Now she's an elderly woman. She can't drive, and she gives it to you. Let's pretend the basis that she paid for it was $20,000. The value is lower. The value is only $5,000 on the date she gave it to you. So again, now you have this lower of cost or market problem. The value isn't higher. The value is lower at that date. Because normally you take the rollover cost of $20,000, but the value is lower. The value is only five. So which basis do you use? I don't know. Well, how will you know? Here's the crazy rule. The basis to be used is based upon what you sell it for. That's right, what you sell it for. So if I take grandma's car, and I fix it up, I spruce it up, and I sell it for above $20,000, I use the $20,000, her cost, to determine the gain on anything above. What happens if I drive it for a few more years, I beat it up even more, and it's worth even less than $5,000, the value on the day I got it? Then you use $5,000 to determine the loss. And what happens if I sell it for anything between those two amounts? If I sell it for anything between those two, no gain or loss on the sale. Crazy rules, aren't they? Very crazy. Well, take a look at my passkey. Again, the donor's basis, think of that as the $20,000, and think of my hand as being that line. The lower fair value at the date of gift, think of that as the five. Again, now if you sell it for below five, you use the fair value to determine the loss. If you sell it for above 20, you use grandma's cost to determine the gain. And if you sell it in between those two amounts, no gain or loss. Crazy rules, so you can imagine the examiners like to test on that one. To illustrate, we're going to get into an example at the bottom in just a moment. Now, letter D, holding period. The recipient of the gift, that's us, normally assumes the donor's holding period. So if grandma owned that car for 30 years, it's long-term to me. If grandma had just bought the car 4 months ago, then my holding period is deemed to be just the 4 months plus whatever I hold it afterwards. Well, let's illustrate this with four simple examples at the bottom. All right, first of all, circle in the first one, higher, fair value higher. So we have donor is 20,000, the fair value is 40. You're gonna use the 20 no matter what. You're gonna use the 20 no matter what. So you could even cross out the 40. You'll never use that because it's higher at the date of the gift. So again, if you ultimately sell it for 30, you're going to use the 20 and you have a gain of 10. All right, now 2, 3, and 4 deal with fair value is lower at the date of gift. Same $20,000 car. Under the first example, it's going to be under the first, second, and third, $13,000 basis. So now, if you sell it for more than 20, you sell it for 25, you use the cost to determine the gain. Now, in the second example, you're going to sell it In the second case, for below the 13, then you use the 13 to determine the loss of 3. And in the fourth example, you're going to sell it right between the 20 and the 13. You're going to sell it for 15. Then again, you use that as the basis, so there's 0 gain or loss. Crazy rules, but again, you got to know them. All right, and now let's go on to the third and final way that you can acquire property. And this is inherited property basis. Highlight that. And next to that, would you please put step up and then put in brackets down, step up to fair market value. Step up, bracket down to fair market value. When you inherit property, literally you're going to receive the fair market value on the date of the property. So, following rules. General rule, the date of death fair market value becomes your basis. They call it the step up, but theoretically it could be a step down. All right? Now, why is that the case? Because the estate is taxed on the value of all the property. Since the estate is paying tax, they pay a tax on the fair value, and then the fair value becomes the basis, and they transfer it over to you. Now, the fair value at the date of death. Now, highlight letter B, alternative valuation date, and go down below the first paragraph. If the alternative valuation date is validly elected, the asset is valued using the fair value at the earlier of, underscore earlier of as well, distribution date of the asset, or the alternative valuation date, which is the earlier of 6 months after death or the date of distribution. So it's, again, never more than 6 months. Out in the margin, put maximum 6 months. So if the property is distributed within the first 6, you use that date. If the property is distributed after 6 months, you use the valuation at the 6 month date. And then finally, highlight letter C, holding period. Property acquired from a decedent is automatically considered to be long-term property, regardless of how long it was actually held by the deceased. And underscore long-term. Now, the way I've always explained this when I'm in a live class, and certainly it has a lot more impact, is I would say, again, for inherited property, somebody had to die, and I would hide behind the table in the front of the room. And then I would say, you have to step up out of the grave. And I would jump up on top of the table, and I would say, you'd have to step up out of the grave to hand this property to your, again, beneficiaries. So you get the step up to the fair market value. And then I stand up there and I would say, and it's a long journey out of the grave. So you automatically get long-term treatment on any property owned by the decedent that's now passed to you. All right, with that, let's show you some examples. Assuming a taxpayer inherited property from a decedent, the fair market value at the date of death was $20,000. The property was worth $15,000 6 months later, and was worth $22,000 when it was distributed 8 months later. Well, you can cross out the $22,000. It's way beyond the alternative valuation date. All right. It had a cost basis to the decedent of $5,000. You can cross that out. Who cares about cost? It's the step up to the fair value. What is the basis of the inherited property? If the alternative valuation is not elected, I would underscore not elected, then you're going to use the date of death, $20,000. B, if the alternative valuation was elected, underscore was elected, then you're going to use the date 6 months later of $15,000. Now, what happens if the property was sold for $25,000? Well, if the property was sold for $25,000, circle the $25,000, and in 2A, you did not elect the alternative valuation, it's $25,000 minus $20,000, $5,000 is your gain. And in 2B, if it was elected, the alternative valuation, then it's the 15. So it's 25 minus the 15, and it's a $10,000 gain.